Jane Austen, a biography by Elizabeth Jenkins. The 18th century was an age such as our imagination can barely comprehend. The ghost of that vanished loveliness haunts us in every memorial that survives the age. A house in its park, a teacup, the type and binding of a book. But there existed with it a state of squalor and wretchedness, which is nearly as difficult to visualize. In the London slums, Dr. Johnson roughly computed that 1,000 people starved to death every year, and thousands were thrown crippled and destitute, without pension and without charity, on the savage callousness of the officials entrusted with the administration of poor relief. However, it is in the country where Jane Austen's life began, where the roads were unspoiled, often unpaved, and bordered with copse and meadow, orchard and stream. Hampshire, in the district about the village of Steventon, had standing back among the timbered meadows houses of many ages, from the Elizabethan half-manor, half-farmhouse of rosy saffron brick, nestling in the shelter of its hill, to the gentleman's seat, a classical stone building with concealed roof and stone-garlanded pillared front, planned with an eye to views and crowning a gentle tree-covered slope. The village of Steventon was little more than a row of cottages, the important families of the neighbourhood living at some distance on their various estates. On one side of the lane stood a spacious barn. On the other, surrounded by meadows sprinkled with elm and chestnut trees, was the rectory, a house with a flat facade and narrow roof, square sashed windows and a trellised porch. The ground in front had a wide, curving drive, and to the right of it, a plantation of elm, chestnut and fir. At the back, a bow window looked out onto a garden where an alley of turf, bordered by strawberry beds, ended in a sundial. A terrace of turf, shaded by elm trees, ran between the garden and the open meadows and led to a copse, visible from the house's upper windows. The bow window belonged to the rector's study. The Reverend George Austen was a handsome man, with bright hazel eyes and finely curling hair, prematurely white. He was a distinguished classical scholar. He taught all his own children in their early years, and one of his sons, till the latter became of university age. And he augmented his income by taking pupils into the house, three and four at a time, until his own family grew too large for them to be accommodated. He had his strawberry beds, his elm walk, his home meadows, his position in a pleasant neighbourhood as a much-respected country gentleman. But though he kept a carriage, the interior of the rectory had in some respects the plainness of a cottage. In a small front parlour at the right of the front door, Mrs. Austen, with her aristocratic nose, was usually to be found darning the family stockings, whether visitors were there or not. She might, strong in the consciousness of her own, be amusingly particular about other people's noses, but with a growing family on her hands she had no idea of giving in to fine ladyism, and people were welcome to call, provided they did not expect her to put away the mending. She always said that she was no beauty. Her sister Jane was beautiful, but she was merely good-looking and sensible. Yet she had a distinguished air and a decisive epigrammatic turn of speech. It was thought that she had perhaps inherited this from her uncle, Dr. Theophilus Lee, the master of Balliol College, Oxford, whose bon mots were famous. Mrs. Austen's early married life was domestic to the exclusion of every other interest. She bore four sons in little more than 4 years, and when she was not tied to her own house, on one occasion at least, she went to London to nurse a sister-in-law in her confinement. The lady whom she nursed in town was Mrs. Walter, the wife of George Austen's half-brother. Mrs. Austen much preferred her own country existence, and said of her stay in London, "'Tis a sad place. I would not live in it on any account. One has not time to do one's duty either to God or man." Of Mrs. Austen's first four children, the second, George, was subject to fits, and was never able to live with the family. He died in 1827.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.